this actually work? Ah, the magic of technology. Hi, good morning, everybody. So I'm Gilad Ben-Yosef, work for Mellanox, and today I'm going to talk about taking a Linux virtual server, IPVS, to those of us more familiar with name of kernel models than why people actually use them, and accelerating it by porting the code to a network processor with an open source SDK. Now, before I dive into the details, I was struggling when I was making this presentation to explain a little bit of the context, the why do we actually want to do this. And it turns out that I ran in Twitter into this random, really fabulous Japanese word that explained in the most succulent way why. And that word is, and forgive my Japanese accent, tsushigiri, or something like that. Now, tsushigiri means way back to, samurais, and samurais would, manufacture a new katana, a new sword, or learn some new fighting trick. And then he would want to test that. So tsushigiri means for the samurai to find some random passerby, probably at night, and basically trying the katana on them for the purpose of finding out if the thing actually works, which is interesting concept to think about. So what I'm trying to say, the context I'm trying to give here, is that this work that I'm presenting is a kind of tsushigiri, okay? We have, in Mellanox, this new network processor, which is program in C. We open source the API, and we wanted to come out and figure out what useful thing can we do with it. How can, for example, we can make it a first-class citizen in Linux networking, hooking up to the Linux kernel like SwitchDev and so on. So we had a whole bunch of questions we didn't know the answer to, and the best way to find out is go out and try. And we needed a victim, right? Something useful to try to do. So this sets up the context of what we're doing, doing a tsushigiri of taking Linux virtual server and basically porting it into an open source NPU. So what is LVS, a Linux virtual server? This is taken straight from the project, open source project website. It's L4 load balancer, right? Software that sits, its data plane is a Linux kernel model in the Linux networking stack. It basically sits behind a whole set of real servers that serve the traffic. It gets the traffic, decides dynamically which of the servers needs to get it, and makes sure that from now on, every request that comes on the same session goes to the same server that it picks. That is really in a nutshell. And why is it interesting? Why is it a good tsushigiri? Well, if you think about it, you really want to do something like this with something that at least seems useful, right? So LVS is useful. It's being used in the real world for quite some time. Just lately, I found on the web, like Wikipedia is using that as a load balancer, or at least, that's what they published. I ran into this talk by somebody from Uber describing how they use that to load balance containers. We know Google has been using it up to some point in the past because they published some open source management stack. I forgot the name, Seesaw, that they're using it. Although, as I think Dave Miller touched upon in his talk, recently Google, and that is, again, public knowledge because they published a paper on this and some of the other, usual suspects in the arena, moved to use homegrown, bypass the kernel networking, bypass the kernel networking stack implementation for load balancing. And the stated reason is that if you think about it, load balancing is kind of tricky, right? If you have a whole bunch of servers and you want to load balance the traffic to it, the load balancer, in a sense, there needs to be some entity that actually gets all the traffic and then reroutes it to the real server, which is kind of tricky because you started off with the problem that one server is not capable of handling all the traffic. That's why you want to load balance it. And now you have to have this entity that somehow gets all the traffic and sends it back. Now, what I said is not completely accurate, but because the web server, to take an example, probably is doing different and more work than the load balancer, but you can kind of get to why you would really want to do something which is really scalable when you're talking about load balancing, which is, I guess, why they thought they needed to do that. So this is LVS as we know it. It exists for a long time, part of the Linux kernel. And what we did is basically took LVS, or specifically the Linux kernel model IPVS that implements the data plane in the kernel, and ported it into our network processor. Now, in order to explain what that means, I want to tell you a little bit what is a network processor, because I'm pretty sure not everybody knows. So NPS 400, that's the name of the product, is a network processor. And if you want to understand what a network processor is, think sort of like GPU, but not for graphics, but for networking, right? It's kind of a specialized processor that's really bad by anything except what it's specialized for, right? So if you want to play Doom on an NPU, it's actually possible to compile the code and run it, but the performance would be horrible. But network processing, this is something it knows to do well and very, very well. An NPU is not a fixed function ASIC where you configure it, right? It's something you program. You actually write the program that processes the packets, and it can do it at interesting line rates because it's specialized. And NPUs are not anything in any way, shape, or form. But what happened is that in the old world, you know, legacy world, they used to be buried, right? You would go to, say, Cisco to pick a random name, and for $1 million or so, we'll buy a monster like this Acer 9K service router here. And actually, inside, it would be composed with a hell of a lot of stuff, among it, network processor. So Cisco, again, is just the name of a random vendor, would actually be programming those NPUs, but the fact it's programmable will not help or not manifest to anybody actually buying the platform. And what we at Mellanox are doing, and actually this that specific product actually uses the predecessor of this NPS product inside. It's not that I picked it in random. And what we at Mellanox are doing is just like we started doing with the switching ASIC and switch dev, right, opening up the SDK to the world and the data center, we want to do the same thing with network processor. We wanted to bring it to everybody. Therefore, what we did, first, you know, it's a Mojave level kind of thing. We're creating system, us and partners, so people could just buy a box with this thing inside, so you can have something to run it on. But I think more important in this context, we took the existing SDK that we had for this big customer and open source it, right? So it's still an SDK, but at least it's open source, BSD and GPLv2. So this is NPS, a network processor, and what a network processor is. And this, in a sense, describes what we did, okay? This line of servers here is what is known in the load balancing industry as the real servers, right? This is what is doing the actual real service. There's a bunch of them, and each one of them is configured to be able to receive traffic for a virtual IP, right? The same virtual IP that is shared by everyone. So when, for example, you go to facebook.com, that resolves to some IP, which isn't real in the sense that it does not belong to any specific server, the whole bunch of servers that answer to that IP. That is the virtual IP. There's some, you know, switch, obviously, that connects the router that gets the traffic from the customer. That connects all these servers, and to that switch, or later actually inside that switch, but at least for starters, it's a separate box. Although if you think about it, it really makes sense to put them inside. There's some entity called the load balancer, right? And that load balancer, what it does, it advertises to the world via ARP, right? That VIP, this is my IP. And then when a request comes, by the natural order of things, it will go to the load balancer that will get it, and the logic there will actually make the decision which of these servers need to get that request. And its whole job in life is to make sure that it, A, makes the right decision, and B, from now on, every packet that comes for that request will be sent to the same server that was originally picked, because, you know, that's how TCP works. There's some nice trick you can do called direct server routing. You don't actually have to see the replies. You can, but if you set things upright, and I'm not going to go into the details because my time is short, you can have the servers answer directly and not go through the load balancer. If you don't understand why, catch me up later. Now, what we really did is that all of this have been working for years with Linux, with LVS and IPVS kernel model. As you can see above, there's some, you can sort of think about it as a control plane, it's a daemon. There's a couple of these we like keep alive D, but there's nothing special about it. It manages all this stuff and sees all the servers. And it uses some let-nick-click messages to program the IPVS Linux kernel model so that a packet comes into the kernel that answers the right rules to do the right thing. And the only thing is, this is limited to what, you know, a server with a NIC can do, which can be quite large if you do the right thing, but it's still limited by the fact that you're running on a general purpose processor with a NIC. So even if you have the best software in the world, still you're limited by the hardware. And what we did is basically hook up a network processor to this configuration and said, we took the IPvS kernel model and just ported it into the NPU and hooked them up so that when you, when KeeperIFD sends the netlink commands to the kernel, in parallel, we keep the configuration inside the Linux kernel, so that is actually useful as a sort of a slow path if there's stuff we're not handling, not all protocols and so on. But for the stuff we are handling, we also download basically the equivalent rules to the ported model on the NPU. And since the NPU is purposely built to do this, we can get load balancing in 400 gigabits per second with 200 millions of concurrent flows, which is more than a PC can do, right? A PC as a general name for an x86 box with a NIC. So this is what we did. And to understand a little bit more on the details, I would like to just give a little bit of notion of what this NPU is. Why can we do our 400 gigabit per second? What's the difference from a NIC and so on? Just to give it a little bit of flavor of the thing. So NPS 400, 400 is actually, you know, derived from the fact that we're targeting the ability to do a line rate of 400 gigabit per second. Of course, it depends on what exactly you're doing and so on, but if you want to have some watermark, that is it. That actually means that the hardware is capable of handling 600 million packets per second as the wire speed with 96 gigabit per second of oversubscription. That means you can hook up if you really want to, I don't know why, 96 different 10 gigabit ports, they're all connected, but in real life, we can actually process traffic if they all fire at once of just 400 gigabit per second, right? This is what it means. And it comes built in with a hardware traffic manager, so stuff like HTTP and software, this thing can do in hardware, not really related to what you're doing there, but I'm just saying. And it's actually an extremely powerful thing. Remember I said NPU is sort of like GPU, but for networking. So it's built from 256 cores. Each one of them actually has 16 SMT threads. So if I go into this thing and to the shell, right, and do cut proc CPU info, I'll tell, hey, I have 4K CPUs. Oh, and yes, by the way, it does run Linux. And yes, the support for that is upstream. So it's SMP Linux. Now, I don't want to mislead you. I'm not saying that it uses the Linux networking stack on the network processor to do this because it's just not built to be run on NPU. I'm going to touch a little bit on that later on. I'm not saying it's not possible. I'm just saying it's not doing it right now. So Linux is actually being used as sort of a management plane, if you will, right? You log in, you can run your program, and so on. The actual program that does the packet processing is a Linux user space program, but it's not using any of the Linux networking stack. It just drives the IO engine. It does actually know it does networking from Linux perspective. So there's a whole bunch of hardware acceleration engine, right? If you want to compute AES or SHA or something like that, there's some hardware engine inside that does this. And it actually hooks up to a lot of memory, up to 96 gigabytes of memory, which means for our perspective that, for example, for a load balancer, it can keep the state of a hell of a lot of rules, hell of a lot being 200 million in our specific case. And as I said, it's programmable. We're writing a C Linux user space program with a library we provide, which comes with the SDK, which we have open sourced. So this was a few explanation of what is this NPU is. So now I'm going to describe the process of what we did. And remember, this is Tsuchigiri, right? So you are about to see, we didn't necessarily do the right thing. We did what can be done to work to see what needs to be done to get to the right thing. And the reason I'm saying this, as you see, because what we did is we took the Linux kernel with the IPvS model inside and so on, and basically did this, and I'll explain why. So we have what we call a host, right, which is, the same x86 with the same Linux kernel. It's connected to the NPS that happens to be running Linux as well, and we ported the data plane program to it, right? We took IPvS, we ported it to this different API, and sadly, there is a comparable part of the SDK a library that allows a host to configure that NPS. Ideally, what we want to do is to take that, shove it in some sort of a Linux kernel driver to let the Linux kernel networking stack control that directly, just like SwitchDev does for switching and routing. Sadly, this is not what we did right now at this stage, mainly for a really simple reason that that library right now, remember, we started with the existing proprietary product and we just open source it. It just isn't built as a Linux kernel model. So we're actually working on this, but we didn't want to stop and wait until that is ready in order to do this experiment. So what we did is build this daemon that basically listens to netlink messages and program using the still open source, but uses PSDK, the NPS as a workaround. Okay, so that means that from a user perspective, when he logs on to this host, he's using the normal set of IPvS or LVS commands, KeepAliveD, and so on. The user is not aware of anything, except a few things I will say later. But we are listening to the netlink communication with the kernel and program the NPU in parallel. And again, I do understand that the right architecture is not to do this. It's to do some switch dive kind of thing or XDP, but I'm getting to that later on. Okay, so what did we ended up with? So the KeepAlive daemon running there. We have our LVS daemon listening to netlink sockets. It has this library inside that basically can program the program that is running on the CPU. It accesses via PCI. And so when basically a packets come, it arrives via a port that is connected to the NPU itself. And the program running here, just like IPvS in the Linux kernel, will ask the question, is this a packet that is destined to IPvS, right? Is this something I need to load balance? If it does, then it just processes it and shoots it out, exactly like one of the XDP examples that we heard about yesterday. And if it doesn't, or if it's still an IPvS packet, but one of the schedulers, for example, we didn't have time to port and so on, it just shoots it up to the Linux kernel as usual. That's the general architecture. Anyway, a few minutes, so I can say a few more interesting words. So we really wanted to port it more the thing to make it complete, not just, you know, a proof of concept. So for example, IPvS, LVS has a facility for active-passive synchronization for failover. So I actually ported that using the exact, of course, same protocol because the exact same code. And it actually works, right? So you can set two of these in the active-passive kind of environment. And in theory, and I'll say why in theory in a sec, you can actually set two of these where one of them is with the NPU and one of them isn't, right? It's the same software. And we actually wanted to make use of this because one of the things that bugs us is if you do this, well, one of the things that LVS lets you do is using some IPvS admin command, see a bunch of statistics, right, of the flow that is being processed at the same time. Once I'm doing this flow processing inside the NPS, of course, the kernel no longer has visibility for that. So it seems like if you do this, that you're not processing anything. Well, the synchronization protocol for passive-active actually passes the needed information to a second box, so you will be able to see the flows that are being processed in the active box. And our first plan would actually to use the same mechanism to synchronize the Linux kernel. I mean, it's kind of abusing, but in a good way, I hope, an existing mechanism to send state information between the kernel and the NPU, just like to machine the passive and active synchronous state. And in theory, it works. But the problem is that the difference between practice and theory, that in theory there is no difference, but in practice there is, right? So what ended up happening is when we tried to do this, so the NPU can process 400 gigabit per second, 200 million flows. Well, way, way, way before 200 million flows, when you're trying to send off the state to the host, it just blows up, right? It digs a too big a table, or it's actually a tree in memory, in order to do anything except try to process the aging of that thing and just, you know, locks up. Now, it might be. It certainly might be that somebody may either show us what we did wrong in configuration to IPvS to hold all that, or that one can change the code to optimize that. But it does open up the question. It's an interesting question. If you're a slave, and the NPU is most certainly a slave, right? It's just like a network, a NIC that does, I don't know, a VLAN offloading or GRO for the Linux kernel stack, has some state, and its transient state is bigger than what you want online to synchronize. Probably the way you want to do is not to put all this needless information in the host memory. Maybe you would like to do a mechanism just like statistics normally or can work with just a netdev, right? That when the user is interested in the statistics, I will go down to the hardware or the NPU and ask for it instead of keeping the state. It's insane, but if you compare it to, let's say, switch dev and the routing table, that is not exactly what we're doing here. So it's an open question what to do when the transient state is bigger than what you want to shove into the host memory. Okay, so a few words about, let's say, status of this thing, right? So we really wanted to do something which is a good tsuzugiri. That means that it will actually work, right? We can put it in front of somebody and say, hey, look, it's useful, or what would you want to use it? We wanted to run into all the real issues. For that, you really want to touch all of the corner cases, or at least in some vector. So we built this thing as, it's from startup land, right? MVP, minimal viable product, which means if you look at these two, exemplification, that we're not trying to cut this very deep and wide kind of feature, but we're trying to do that kind of thing that goes into all layer of, feasible, valuable, usable, and so on. What this means is what we did, the status, the current status, is that it's minimal in the sense that we only implemented the single forwarding mode out of the three supported by LVS, right? Just DSR, not tune and or not. We implemented the three of the scheduling algorithm out of the 10 possible, and we only support TCP and IPv4, but we can add all the rest. But it's implemented just like, of course, IPvS itself, because it's, it's the same kind of code, in a modular fashion. So you can always add more models. In our specific case, it's also implemented in a way that if you configure something we don't support, we simply shoot it up to the kernel. So it continues to work, just unaccelerated. That's the minimal part. Viable means that it's really LVS, right? For somebody enters the host, put IPvS, the IPvS admin command or keep alive D, it just works. They're not aware of it except from that thing about the statistic not being visible. So it's the same API, it's Netlink, it's the same CLI because we didn't touch it, same kernel model and so on. It's remote. It's really, we built this to be a narrow but real product quality. So for example, when we did testing, we actually ran into an actual bug in LVS itself, in IPvS kernel model, and contacted the maintainer and so on, just because we were doing testing and something went wrong in our code, and we went into the LVS code and saw, well, it's doing the same thing, but that's obviously wrong. That was very interesting. And as I already mentioned, we do support passive-active failovers. So it's something you can use in the real world. And it's a product, right, in the sense that, not in the sense of I'm going to sell it to you, but it's something beyond a proof of concept, in the sense that it really works. It does roughly 400 more time performance than just the server with a NIC. Not because of some magic, because you're using, instead of a NIC, an NPU. And it's kind of interesting from a use perspective, because what people are doing today, right, they're trying to put the load balancer on a server. So they try sort of to scale the load balancing with the amount of server they load balance, which is, interesting. But if you think about load balancing, think about this poor packet, right? It goes hit the top of rack switch, then it goes to the load balancer, then the load balancer redirects it, sends it back to the switch, and then send it off to the real server for processing. In a sense, you really want to say, I'm only hitting the switch there, and it's really, sending stuff up. If I can only do that logic in the switch, that will actually be a saner place to do this, right? Because I will go to the switch, it will do switching and load balancing, then set it off. I'm saving a lot of latency. But I want to do this only if my switch is really, can run LVS. It's open source, it's programmable, doing my thing. And now, at least in the sense of open source, you can, right? You can build a switch that has this NPU, and if you hook things right, you're basically running LVS on the switch itself. And I think that's an interesting value proposition. So I'm going to talk a little bit about performance. I already mentioned some of the results. Not going to spend much time on this, but just this is the setup we used to test the thing. So there's some Ixia breaking point, interesting name, that can generate stateful traffic that you actually need in order to do real load balancing. We hooked it up to a switch, the load balancer and to the system as a test. And the Axia sits with both parts, right? Because it also plays both the client and the server. You're actually testing the load balancer. And the interesting thing is that, well, we were actually limited by the performance of the Axia equipment that we had. It's just too damn expensive. So we only got one with 100 gigabits per second port, which actually can't do 100 gigabit per second. It maxes out at somewhere at 80. So I'm just saying this so you understand that the result I'm showing you is actually limited by the testing equipment. So I know you can see the graph very well. It's not that important. It's just a screenshot from the Axia GUI. This shows really the test. So this is the lab test, but we actually ran all real equipment. And because we were limited by the capacity of the testing equipment, what we did is simply limited the NPU to use 1/4 or 25% of the cores, right? So we just said, you know, I'm going to shut down 3/4 of your capacity artificially, and then, you know, I have some, and see how that goes. And we actually have a simulator that can simulate the hub. On that, I'm showing the expected result if we were able to use the whole system. So concurrent connection on the real life test is 30 million, which, again, to the best of my knowledge, is already beyond what just, you know, the Linux using a NIC can do, not because of any limitation in the software, just sizes of caches and so on. We can go to 128 million per second, million concurrent connection with the actual code, and actually with a small code change, we can actually go to 200 million, right? There needs to be some more logic added. The connection setup rate that we actually measured on Win hardware, again, it's 25% of the capacity of the chip, is 1 million per second. And we forecast, the simulation says, no problem to go to 3 million per second. We actually can go more, right? It's probably just not useful. And request bandwidth, we measured, again, limited by the testing equipment, 75 gigabit per second. And we can show in the simulation, and we actually have other code, not stateful, that we can use another traffic generator too, that we can handle 400 gigabit per second. Okay, so what does that mean? Remember, we started doing this because we wanted to test an idea, how to hook up an NPU in a useful way with open source code to the Linux networking stack, how to really bring it to something like SwitchDev. So first off, it seems useful, right? If you need load balancing, if you like the LDS model, but you were limited because your card can do 10 gigabit per second or 40, if the caches of the Intel limit you to you know, this many connection per second, now you can go to 100 million connection and 400 gigabit per second. So yes, it seems useful to do. Obviously, already stated before, the right way to do things is to take that EZCP, that user space library, make a proper Linux kernel model out of it so we can really hook it up to the Linux kernel, sort of like a SwitchDev model. So this is just work we need to do and are executing on. The more interesting question is, okay, we have that low-level driver inside the kernel, now what? You know, how do you hook it up? Is it a SwitchDev-like model? That sounds kind of interesting. But for NPU, which is programmable, that, you know, one day does load balancing, the other day can do, I don't know, TC offload. This is actually what we're working on now. That's why I'm saying this. It's programmable, so I'm not sure the SwitchDev metaphor, in a sense, works. Maybe something like XDP. And I swear to God that I put this before I heard that XDP is the greatest thing in the world, because this is really what we're thinking. It kind of makes sense, but I'm going to touch on the bot in a while. So these are the first two questions, and going to go real fast because of the time. You don't need to understand all this complicated slide. It's kind of the almost marketing-like vision. But in essence, it boils down to what I was saying before. If we do our things right, we put that driver into the Linux kernel, and then we can hook it up either to SwitchDev, as one example, or to something like XDP that, you know, somebody downloads a program from user space to the kernel, and it can go down all down to the NPU. So this is a vision where we want to go ahead, and it will be very interesting to hear the feedback of what people here think we should do. Which one of them, both of them, I don't know. And the last two notes before I turn to question is, you know, stuff we ran into, okay, the question mark. So we started off with IPvS source code and reported it to an NPU, but when we ended up on the end result, we realized that although it's the same program and it does the same thing, the end result looked quite different than what we started out with. And it came down to not semantics and this API looks like this and so on, but something substantial. Okay, there's stuff like a network processor, the way it works, Forgive me, I'll start in a different way. A NIC with the Linux kernel, the way it works is it takes a packet using RSS, it makes sure that all the packets of the same flow hits the same core, right? And of course the code assumes this. A network processor, on the other hand, does the complete opposite. It takes the packets of the flow and spreads them over all the 4K virtual CPU and let them processes being processed in parallel, and then it has smart algo to put them back in order so you don't need to worry. So if you take the same program and just port it, you don't get something that has the same assumption. And this, I think, has some interesting implication on, for example, using XDP. Sure, you can use this thing as the best eBPF accelerator in the world, but if we're not doing the architecture right, expecting to write an XDP program that is meant to run in the Linux kernel and take the exact same program and put it on the network processor, it will work, but it probably won't reach the performance that you want to get. So we need to think, if you want to go this way, what do we want to do? Do we really want to put hooks inside XDP in the thinking that this might run on something with other properties? Maybe it's not useful, I don't know, something to think about. The other issue we ran into, already mentioned, there's this notion that you really want to treat the NPU as sort of a slave device of the kernel. And ideally, I would say that means that the kernel needs to be completely aware of everything that happens. But when you try to take huge amount of transient state, like what exactly is happening in one of these 200 million flow, and push it up into the Linux kernel, well, maybe it's not a good idea. It's doing a lot of, keeping accounting over something it's not actually used. Maybe a better thing would be a semantics, but you go and ask the hardware when the user asks you to, just like you do with a net dev going to ring some hardware counters when the user cares about. So this is all what I had to say. Here are the URL for where you can get the OpenNPU SDK, open source with the source code and everything, and the GitHub with the LVS code we have. Questions? Yes. Microphone for Dave, please. I'm going to deduct the time it takes to bring in a mic from the time I have. I'm just kidding.
So one thing I think that's really interesting here is that we have basically two instances of NPS device. We have the Netronome and we have your stuff, right? And it's kind of interesting to see how different people approach adding Linux support for these kind of things. And from what I understand, the current Netronome situation is that they have a BPF translator and they also support things like the TC offloads too at the same time, which is kind of interesting because they can do flow offloading and stuff like that. One issue that seems to come up once you go to the BPF model and you start supporting things like XDP is what to do with the maps. Because in both cases, the Netronome and yours, you put the whole table into the memory of the card and then you let the BPF program access the memory directly with your JIT translated programs for the NPU. Then the question becomes, we have to decide what the semantics of the maps are. For example, we can have read-only maps, which are fine. You can put them in the card. You're never changing it, and therefore we don't need synchronization between the kernel in CPU memory copy and the one that's on the card. The next case we have is something like statistics, where the card's updating counters all the time, and on a periodic basis, the kernel's going to want to synchronize the in-memory copy. And then you have another situation, which is kind of what you're talking about with the IPvS state situation, where you have the state table, and there's a push and pull kind of situation going where the kernel in-memory copy may need to be pushed to the device, and vice versa, the device may update the state table with FDB kind of learning situations and push it back to the kernel copy. We don't have any interface to handle this right now, so it's really, I was talking with Simon Horman the other night, and the thing we came up with is that we need operations for a push and a pull of a map, and some high-level construct and management state piece of software that triggers these events. So this is something that you're going to have to look at, think about in the future, but realize that we understand that this is a problem and we're going to have to provide facilities for that once you start adding XDP and BPF support. So I really like the idea of having the device as a first-class citizen in the Linux kernel and pushing offload state into it. I think that's really the long-term way to go. It's just my opinion.
Thank you. Can I quote you on that?
Absolutely. You can do it. And you can also say that DPDK is not Linux.
I agree. Thank you very much. Do we have time for one more question? If we do? Yes, somebody in the back.
Yeah, I was wondering about the numbers you show, and you were telling that you support 1 million flows per second, right? Do you remember what
packet... That's a setup rate. Actually, we can go up to 3. We just measured 1 million.
Yeah, did you remember what packet size you were using for that?
Yes, 400 bytes packets.
400.
It's iMix, right? We used iMix just because this is what makes sense, I think, for load balancing.
Okay.
So... If you're interested in, you know, the actual details, catch me up later. I can tell you the exact number for 64, okay. For whatever.
Okay, then, well, I will try to make sure I do the test we made with NF tables that Laura made, because she showed just that we can achieve 300 SOTHAN without saturating, actually. The core was showing quite relaxed. So, I mean, the other concern is that if we can do this in software, it looks more flexible to me. But anyway, let's try to get more numbers and put them together.
Absolutely. Thank you. Okay, if there's no more questions, so thank you very much, and beware of summarizing with new source.